Hello, I'm James Schopf, political science professor and director at Keimyung University's Academia Vieserica Institute here in Daegu, South Korea. I'd like to welcome you to our annual Silk Roads Arts and Humanities online conference entitled Exchange and Conflict in Central Asia, From Antiquity to the Present. We're proud to make available to you 11 thought-provoking presentations offered by some of the world's most prolific scholars in the fields of Central Asian studies, history, anthropology, politics, development, and international relations. I strongly encourage you to take a look at the conference lectures available here today on our website. The question of my talk today is this: are we likely to see cooperation or conflict in the future of the Silk Road region? Hegemony brought cooperation and exchange in the region of the Silk Road under the Mongol Empire, and most recently exchange with the Silk Road region and the world re-emerged again following the end of the Cold War. At present, the U.S. unipolar moment seems to be coming to an end as China's economic power surpasses America's, with Russia remaining behind. While enhanced cooperation between Russia and China has offered the countries in Central Asia and the Caucasus, the region of the Silk Roads, more opportunities for exchange, increased hostility between the U.S. and China and between the U.S. and Russia threatens the possibility of another Cold War. Is that likely to occur? What type of future can we expect to see in the Silk Road region? To answer that question, I will examine past relations between the U.S., China, and Russia to see how shifts in the balance of power and in ideology affected cooperation between them, and to see how those factors influence their future interaction. So, let's take a look at the region of the Silk Roads. The Silk Roads were a network of trade routes connecting the East and West from Japan and Korea through China, Central Asia, and the Caucasus to Europe. And they facilitated economic, cultural, political, and religious exchange throughout this region from the 2nd century BC to the 18th century. The relations between the US, Russia, and China affect the likelihood for cooperation and exchange in this region today. And when I say Silk Road region, in particular what I have in mind in addition to Russia and China are the five states of Central Asia: Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and Kyrgyzstan, and the three states of the Caucasus: Georgia, Armenia, and Azerbaijan. The theoretical perspective I primarily apply here today is that of neorealism, which takes as a key assumption an anarchical world in which nation-states are each intent on preserving their own sovereignty. The key causal factor is the distribution of power in the international system, which can influence the likelihood of cooperation and conflict. The three main polar power distributions in the international system are that of unipolarity with a single great power, bipolarity with two competing superpowers, and multipolarity with over five great powers. To preserve their sovereignty, states will seek to balance against power. And following the ideas of Stephen Walt, I assume that states balance most rigorously against perceived threat, rather than only against power imbalances. The different distributions of power can affect the likelihood for cooperation and exchange. As Charles Kindleberger argued, by partially mitigating the effects of anarchy in a unipolar world, the hegemon can establish rules and norms to build a free trade system. While bipolar systems have the advantage of being highly stable, competition between the two superpowers is likely to lead to the formation of two independent trading blocks with limited cooperation between them. Trade remains possible in a multipolar world characterized by a shifting system of alliances in which states neither view enemies nor allies as being permanent. In his conference lecture here today, Columbia University professor Morris Rosabi describes a flourishing exchange of goods and culture, religion, and scientific, technical, medical, and other advanced knowledge along the Silk Roads under the unified rule of the Mongol Empire in the late 13th century. More recently, bipolar Cold War competition between the Soviets and the Americans closed down cooperation and trade between the Silk Road region and the rest of the world. In the early days of the Cold War, Russia, China, the Caucasus, and Central Asia were separated from Western Europe, the U.S., and their allies in East Asia, South Korea, and Japan. Beginning in the late 1960s, a border war between China and the Soviet Union further separated China from Central Asia and Mongolia. The United States and China first normalized relations in 1979. Then the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991 brought about what has been called the American unipolar moment and helped to revive exchange between Central Asia and the rest of the world. The balance of power continues to shift, however. China's economy has grown to surpass the U.S., with Russia lagging behind. Authoritarian governments in Russia and China have moved closer together in opposition to the perceived threat posed by American liberalism. Will this new global division bring an end to exchange and cooperation, separating Russia and China from the U.S., as during the onset of the Cold War? Or will Russia and China break off relations with one another, as in the late 1960s? To answer these questions, I'll take a look at the important relations between these three major powers, the U.S., China, and Russia, beginning first with relations between the U.S. and China. U.S.-China relations reveal the danger and instability resulting from a power transition, in which an ascending power challenges the position of the dominant or hegemonic power in order to rewrite the rules of the international system. Other than the peaceful transition of power from Britain to America, these hegemonic challenges and transitions have almost always culminated in a war between the two parties, which Graham Allison has termed the Thucydides trap. China's economy, which grew at an annual rate of 10% from the mid-1980s, has driven its emergence as a great power. Tensions between it and the United States arose as China's power approached and began to surpass that of America. China's increased assertiveness has been matched by a shift in U.S. policy from engagement towards balancing. China's grand strategy from 1990 to 2010 has been dubbed the Peaceful Rise. In essence, China pursued a peaceful policy, buying time for its economy to grow, for a future confrontation with the United States. China adopted a largely defensive military doctrine and allowed itself to be constrained through participation in multilateral institutions, such as the ASEAN Regional Forum. Under Bill Clinton, the U.S. sought to constructively engage China, encouraging trade and Beijing's accession to the World Trade Organization in December 2001, in the hopes that exposure to Western political and cultural values would encourage domestic political liberalization. Bilateral trade between the two countries increased from $20 billion in 1990 to $660 billion in 2018. As Chinese power gradually grew to equal that of the U.S., China adopted a more assertive military policy, which it matched with generous development lending through the Belt and Road Initiative, or BRI, to lessen hard balancing against its rise in power. In 2010 and 11, China became the world's largest exporter and manufacturer, respectively, and by 2014, it had passed the United States as the world's largest economy based on purchasing power parity. RAND security expert Roger Cliff predicted that by 2020, Chinese military power in East Asia would begin to approach that of the U.S., and the U.S. has sought to project its power and military power across Europe and the Middle East as well. So within East Asia, the two would be at a parity. In 2013, President Xi Jinping shifted from a policy of keeping a low profile to that of striving for achievement, adopting a more aggressive military posture. China confronted the Philippines over the Scarborough Shoal, and reclaimed land in the South China Sea to bolster territorial claims and perhaps deny U.S. military access to the area within the first island chain. China also expanded its naval presence in the Indian Ocean. China increased military spending 11-fold from 1990 to $228 billion in 2017 and improved its military capabilities with up-to-date offensive weapons systems like the J-20 stealth fighter and Type 55 Aegis destroyer. At the same time, though, the Belt and Road Initiative, or the BRI, through the BRI, China provided collective and individual economic benefits to its neighbors, winning goodwill to prevent states from balancing against it. From 2013 to 18, China invested $90 billion and completed some $400 billion worth of infrastructure construction projects in 40 BRI countries. She also established the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, or the AIIB, in 2017, which has lent $9 billion to developing countries in its first 3 years. Chinese financial aid and investment has helped to solidify coalitions with allies such as Pakistan and stop balancing against China in South and Southeast Asia. China's greater assertiveness was matched by a more aggressive response from the United States, which felt threatened by China's greater naval capabilities and growing economic, technological, and industrial might. Under the Obama administration, the U.S. sought to maintain primacy through a pivot to Asia, which would balance against Chinese militarily, politically, and economically. Militarily, the U.S. increased aid and shared intelligence to strengthen and expand multilateral alliances in the Asia-Pacific. To bolster the credibility of its commitment in the face of Chinese anti-access area denial technology, the U.S. deployed 60% of its naval forces to the Pacific, along with advanced ships, aircraft, and strategic offensive weapons and defensive systems to Singapore, Australia, Japan, and South Korea. Obama officials increased visits to the Asian Pacific countries and launched the U.S.-ASEAN summit to address security matters. Economically, Obama negotiated the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or the TPP, Free Trade Agreement, to set trade rules while excluding China. Under Trump's concept of strategic competition, the U.S. has inched closer towards a hard balance against China, launching a trade war with punitive tariffs of $50 billion on Chinese imports, which cut trade with China by 15% since 2017 and sought to cripple China's leading high-tech firms. The Trump administration blamed China for the COVID-19 pandemic, which it used as a pretext to pressure American firms to reshore manufacturing jobs and reorient their supply chains away from China. The Pentagon also began development of a new intermediate-range ballistic missile to counter China's military buildup. Within the U.S., America's conflict with China increasingly became viewed in ideological terms as a competition between American liberalism and Chinese authoritarian communism. So, American-Russian relations have declined as well in recent years. Russia's relative decline in power and resentment at NATO's post-Cold War enlargement and the threat posed by the West's system of liberal democracy has fueled tensions between the two sides. Following the 1991 Soviet collapse, when Russian President Boris Yeltsin sought to improve relations and reintegrate Russia into the global economy, the U.S. moved to contain Russia and prevent it from reimposing influence across the former Soviet Union. NATO and the EU refused to respond to Russian protests to their incorporation of former communist states, and the U.S. refused to consult with the Russians prior to military intervention in the former Yugoslavia. So with the revival of Russia's economy under higher gas and oil prices, Putin assumed the presidency in 2000 and reimposed central control by directly appointing governors and squelching dissent. Russia adopted a more assertive foreign policy with nationalistic rhetoric and expressed hostility towards Western support for the 2003 Georgian Rose Revolution, the 2004 Ukrainian Orange Revolution, and the 2005 Kyrgyz Tulip Revolution, which ousted pro-Russian leaders and sought greater cooperation with NATO and the EU. Russia began to exert economic leverage by cutting off gas to Ukraine in 2006 and 2009, and eventually pulling Ukraine out of the Western orbit through the election of President Viktor Yanukovych in 2010. Yet Russia felt threatened by the EU's neighborhood policy, which sought to extend democratic and market institutions to Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine. Next, the Russians used military intervention through the invasion of Georgia in 2008 to send the message that Russia would no longer tolerate further NATO encroachment into the post-Soviet space. In 2014, Russia responded to the popular overthrow of the Ukrainian Yanukovych regime by annexing Crimea and deploying irregular soldiers to aid pro-Russian militia in eastern Ukraine, destroying Ukraine as a unified state rather than accepting its incorporation into Western economic and political institutions. Russia then set about establishing the Eurasian Economic Union, the EAEU, to promote economic integration among Russia with Armenia, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and Belarus, and strengthen the Collective Security Treaty Organization, the military alliance, linking Russia with Armenia, Belarus, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan, in order to reestablish Russia's dominance and expel Western influence from the post-Soviet space. Russia used energy dependence and ownership of energy infrastructure to exercise leverage over the post-Soviet states. And at the Munich Security Conference in 2007, Putin established Russia as a separate pole in opposition to the West, and later launched a new political ideology, the so-called sovereign democracy model, which was more attractive to authoritarian leaders abroad. Russia placed U.S. global dominance as its top security challenge and sought to divide the U.S. from its European allies and expand Russian influence in the Middle East. Russia supplied the Syrian Assad regime with significant funding and weaponry before directly intervening to lead military operations in September 2015. And to undercut Western democracies, Russia began to interfere in European and American elections. So relations between Russia and the U.S. continued to flounder, despite a 2017 attempt by Russia to reset relations with the Trump administration. So United States relations with Russia and with China have largely deteriorated. Let's take a look now at relations between China and Russia. Hostility towards the U.S. has brought China and Russia to their closest since they were communist allies in the mid-1950s, despite the potential threat posed by a rising China and a declining Russia. As predicted by realism, the two lesser poles have joined forces against the major power in the international system, the U.S. As state-centric autocracies, both Moscow and Beijing also view American-backed political liberalism as their primary threat. Moscow and Beijing thus have formed a near alliance in Central Asia, with Russia preeminent on the political and security issues, and China in charge of economic development. So this Sino-Russian strategic partnership was first proclaimed in 1996, at a time when Moscow felt that it had been unfairly treated as a defeated adversary by the U.S., and Beijing had suffered humiliation in the 1995 and 1996 Taiwan Straits crisis with the U.S. Russia pushed for closer ties with China following its isolation after the Ukrainian crisis of 2014 and the two sides have increased economic and military cooperation since. Russia-China bilateral trade has increased tenfold from 2000 to 2017, with Russia ranking as Russia's top trading partner since 2009, accounting for 15% of overall Russian trade. China relies on Russian natural resources and hydrocarbons and has increased oil imports from Russia by 60% since 2015. The Russian Central Bank has also begun to substitute Chinese holdings and yuan reserves for American assets and dollars. Russia still seeks to restrict Chinese economic leverage, however. It limits Chinese foreign direct investment and refuses to sell the Chinese strategic assets, such as ports, to accept Chinese loans, and it also refuses to pursue free trade or high-tech joint collaborative projects with the Chinese as well. So there are limits to economic cooperation between the two. But military cooperation has increased quite a lot. Alexander Korolev has tracked the increased cooperation between the two countries' militaries. China-Russia military cooperation began with confidence-building measures, such as the demilitarization of the border and information sharing in the 1990s. And this evolved into regular consultation and multi-level information exchanges. By the late 2000s, the two militaries were cooperating to construct jet fighters, aircraft engines, and anti-aircraft weapons. And they now hold 5 to 6 joint military drills each year. Russia has also begun to sell its most developed high-tech weapons, first to China, such as the S-400 surface-to-air missile system and the Su-35 fighter jet, and is thought to be helping China build an anti-ICBM missile defense system as well. So, what have the effects been of relations between the U.S., China, and Russia on the countries of the Silk Road region? Countries in Central Asia and the Caucasus have gained from the cooperative ties between China and Russia, although there have been cases of collateral damage from Russia's conflict with the U.S. Professor Gene Wilson's lecture in our conference explains this topic much better than I do here, but in general, Beijing emerged as the main economic force in Central Asia, while Russia remained the chief political military ally. Chinese and Russian cooperation facilitated the BRI's affiliation with the EAEU, which provided Central Asian nations the opportunity for direct and bilateral and multilateral ties with China and access to Chinese investment, grants, and loans. After Chinese pipelines broke the Russian energy monopoly in 2009, Chinese energy companies moved in to dominate Central Asian gas and oil production. Since 2015, China became the region's main trading partner and investment source. And in fact, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan owe most of their foreign debt to China, and Kazakhstan receives more Chinese investment than Russia does. Kazakhstan suffered collateral damage from Western sanctions on Russia, however, which blocked European goods from reaching the country. For Georgia, Armenia, and Azerbaijan in the Caucasus, China has provided an alternative counterbalance to Russia and the West, and has served as a major source of trade and investment. China and Georgia signed a free trade agreement in 2017, and China pays close attention to Azerbaijan, which accounts for more than 40% of China's trade with the Caucasus. So they've gained a lot through trade between Russia and China, and exchange between the two and cooperative relations. So what does the future hold in store then for relations between China and Russia and between the U.S. and China and U.S. and Russia? The state of U.S.-China ties depends on how well the two can manage China's ascension. The ideal transition case would be something similar to that of America's peaceful surpassing of Britain in 1901, in which Britain conceded to U.S. demands to build and fortify the Panama Canal. While the U.S. and China look likely to remain rivals, several factors favor the continuation of American soft balancing against China rather than the formation of an official anti-Chinese alliance. And these are the following. So first, China rose to power through an American-constructed world order, and it remains committed to globalization and international norms, and has shown a lack of interest in fundamentally altering the international system. China remains linked through trade and finance and supply chains with other states, and is restrained from aggression through active participation in international institutions. China also has used measures like the BRI to win the goodwill of neighbors and prevent formation of counterbalancing coalitions. In addition, the defensive nature of military technology, such as the logic of the nuclear mutually assured destruction, also argues against use of military aggression and reduces the existential threats to China and the United States. Unlike previous rising powers such as the Soviet Union, Germany, and Japan, China has adopted a primarily defensive grand strategy. So, ideological differences seem to pose the greatest challenge to future Sino-American cooperation. Xi Jinping's centralization of control, his repression of dissent in Hong Kong and Xinjiang province, inspires distrust in the United States. And the PRC's party state looks to be quite durable and will likely outlast Xi Jinping's tenure. So it seems that American President-elect Biden will likely seek to adopt a multilateral approach, but will also pressure Beijing on export subsidies, the value of the yuan, and intellectual property. American-Russian ties could improve if the U.S. determined that it needed a neutral Russia to contain China's rise, and recognized Russia's special interest in the former Soviet Union, and maybe if it lifted sanctions. And this would reduce Russia's need to collaborate with China. Russia's regime lacks the strong ruling party of the CCP, and Putin is likely to take Putinism with him when he departs. Thus, a post-Putin Russia could develop into a more liberal and democratic regime, more compatible with Western ideology. President-elect Biden's commitment to NATO, support for Ukrainian sovereignty, and tough line on election meddling, though, may antagonize Russia. He thus appears likely to continue sanctions, but may wish to uphold nuclear arms control treaties. Chinese and Russian cooperation looks to continue through the medium term, but a long-term clash cannot be ruled out. Structural factors, namely China's rapid rise in power, Russia's relative decline, and their 4,300-kilometer-long joint border may prove too much. Long land borders can lead to rivalry over control of a common neighborhood. And previous Russia-Chinese alliances have all failed, most recently in 1969, during clashes along a common border when Russia felt threatened following the Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia. High levels of nationalism and the absence of societal-level trade and interaction between the two sides also pose further obstacles. With a growing dynamic economy, 8 times larger than Russia's, superior high technological capacity, and a formidable military prowess, China could easily threaten Russia by abandoning self-restraint in Central Asia, for instance, by building an open military base in the region, as opposed to the clandestine one that it now operates in Tajikistan, or by vying for allegiance from the region's governments. So, in summary, while the current pattern of Chinese-Russian cooperation in opposition to the United States looks likely to continue in the short to medium term, the world may look very different in 10 to 20 years from now. Well, thank you very much for your interest in Keimyung University's Silk Road Arts and Humanitarians Conference. Please take a look at some of the many interesting lectures available on our website.